Mars Sanctum. My cave of vine and moss is to my right about 10 paces into that thicket that surrounds me now. So dense grows the swampland that sometimes it would take me up to 30 minutes to find the little hideaway I had fashioned, though I had been there hundreds and hundreds of times. I would look for the strips of white sheet, bright like bush ghosts, that hung around the woven walls. They would tell me where. All about me were my treasures, the stained bandages like flags, boxes of nails and tacks, a crate of electrical cord, my hammer, candles and plastic bags full of matches and tapers from the church, my Bibles, twine, animal boxes and feathers and bird skulls, shells and nests, and some of my shoe boxes, about 10. Pictures I'd cut from magazines and threaded through the walls. The tiny blue glass bottles of scented water. And with these I kept my life trophies, my god tokens. The parts of her left behind, blood mementos. The whore's hair, her nightdress. The portrait of Cozy that I had delivered from the hands of those who rose up against her, sheared her, cast her out. The kindergraph and the instructions she had written on back of it in verse. The painting of Beth, of her, fastened to the walls and the ceiling of the grotto, angled so that it hovered above me as I lay in my shell. On a carpet of pink silk and frill, yes, and the 10 pearl buttons leaving their evanescent impression down my back or belly, the stroke of hair, a ruby bead sailing down a yellow strand, a trembling scarlet top, the bittersweet sip, oh, the lifetimes lost in queer congress, hold up in that dark retreat, hold up in that dark retreat, hold up in that a felled tree trunk carved down the middle by a cleaver of lightning during the rain days, I guess, made a kind of pallet where I would lie stretched out between the two halves that I had padded with cardboard and moss, encapsulated by two walls of umbrage that twisted about a few clapboards I had nailed to the trunks as supports, the vines intertwining overhead to form a low ceiling. I could sit up with a full foot's grace, room enough for my angel too, who would come, in my later years, appear on the tree stump at the foot of my cocoon, then come inside and lie with me. Sometimes I heard thousands of voices, for God is many-tongued, whispering things to me as I lay there all alone. All my feelings of fear and of anger and of despair that I ate daily like bread would leave me and I would feel most powerful, most powerful. They taught me, he taught me how to deal with myself at first. Then later, he told me how to deal with the others. O God, I petition thee, hear my cry, and make haste my respite, for I am tired of this day and its most earnest work. Gather up thy servant and bring me home. Lord, there is no place upon this ground of men for me. I have seen complete the matter of thy command. It is done, she is shut down. 3 crows circle overhead. I am coming, Lord, I am coming, for the door to thy kingdom lies not at my head, but at my heel. Call me under, let this mire shut its mouth upon me. Prepareth thee my way, O God, hear my prayer. Call me under and deliver me from bloody men. You would think that being born dumb, stricken of tongue and bereft of the faculty of exchange would have sufficed. You would think that the burdens of mutehood would weigh heavily enough upon the head of a child. Oh no. Whoever was dealing out the bum breaks, whoever was spooning out the woe, must have seen me and upended the whole fucking can because I was dripping in the stuff. hard luck and ill fortune. And an ill wind blew every day, and every night shone forth an evil star, and a day didn't roll past that I wasn't catching some kind of crap. Born a mute and no speak, a speech shy freak, beside the corpse of my brother, in a puddle of pure liquor, in the back of a burned out car wreck, atop of a hill of garbage. That was only the opening hand, a mere whiff of what destiny held in store for me. What maybe I didn't know and my dead brother did, was that we were born of Mar, and that made us two very sorry sprogs indeed. One dumb and one doomed to go in a cot death, we were the sickly issue of truly squalid loins. Unsightly urchins cast from her slum womb into a wicked, wicked world. A world too cruel for such ill-begatters as we. Oh sure, the workers of the fields did hammer me down, and those from the town chased me away, and in the schools the children pelted me with stones, and those at the mill kicked me and kicked me, but I did brave all of those blows that rained down upon me. Indeed, these afflictions paled to insignificance when set against the unending outrage suffered within the bounds of my home. Yes, a most vile enemy there within. Oh, Mama was my true and most unspeakable foe. She was black spit. It was not the valley folk, but the drunken, despotic hell hog who spawned me that really put to test my mettle. Her latter years, I swear, were spent in the relentless pursuit of my misery. Just to think about it even now, 2 full years since her popping off, is enough to chill my chitterlings. It sometimes baffles me, you know, as staff-bearer and rod-raiser to the Lord, chosen to undertake his most ecstatic mission, how the Almighty in all his goodness and grace could conceive such an abomination as she. Or was this vixen built by another more terrible hand? Was she the monster piece of some hellish cosmetician, a limb of Lucifer? Which bloody dungeons did they plumb? Which fucking sewer did they drag? Do you know? Pa beat Mule to death in autumn. For copper and gold were the leaves. I remember because it was the fallen leaves, slippery with morning dew, that made it possible to drag Mule's carcass over to the old water tower. His back had been brutally beaten. I suspected a broken spine. I took the long-handled shovel and began digging, my attention being diverted at times from the business of burial by Mule's cold stare. He was dead and the dead must be buried, everybody knows that. Yet his eyes seemed to beg for mercy, as if it were I who had beaten the life out of the poor brute and not Pa. My spade upturned darker earth. And without any other warning, there upon the blade of my shovel lay what looked like the skeleton of a small dog. Squatting aside the grave and loosing the rust-coloured earth from the fanning bones, I discovered a child's tiny skull. Next, a rotting radius and an ulna connected to a brittle little hand. And by the time I had exhumed my brother's earthly remains, lifting out all his bones intact and laying them out on the soft floor of fallen golden foliage, I was sobbing noiselessly, my eyes streaming. I buried Mule's carcass and laid my brother's skeleton out in an old cutlery drawer I found in the heap. I built a simple sliding lid for it, and taking the box with me into the swampland, I propped it up against the inside back wall of my sanctum. He remained there, my treasured companion, for a good 3 months. That is, until the day that she spooked the Turk's nag into the swamp and the townsfolk found my haven and destroyed it. But that all comes later. I love you, little brother, and I'm coming home. Windowless. My shack is windowless. Once there was a window, three in fact, but I sealed them up with planks. I cemented the ledges in broken bottles, just in case. With the trapdoor in the ceiling shut and the front door closed and the padlocks, bolts and chains checked, I could render the panting interior almost void of light, penetrated only by the steaming needles and fast fins of the guillotines and steak knives of leaked light. Sun-silver lances, like I was the bikini-clad assistant in some magician's trick gone horribly wrong. Yes, sometimes I would watch steely sunlight, ragged, serrated, saw me in half. I spent an afternoon plugging the major leaks with plaster, but the minor clefts, pocks and crannies, the sly seeps and trickles, the countless chinks in my castellated armor are left unhindered. Perforations. Air holes hammered in the lid of my coop, of my coffin. If the beasts were up to it, we would talk in this hushed, sepulchral stillness with the air putrid, septic, heady and receptive. A lot of thought waves got moved around. Rat chat, cackling cat screak, snake hissance and lizard fizz, chipping rabbit blather, hair air, bug thrum. Beast din, muzzled telepathic. Oh, but the drooling dog thoughts, dull, belligerent, doped, full of mean transmission, blood, meat, sex, and so on. Lame, cock-eyed hill bitches agitated into a perpetual state of ostrus, turning mean and nasty as they frot and butt and rut and hump in the ordure and straw, gnash and gravel in their squatting capsules on the floor. When the merging got out of hand, I would give them a goofball, a carmative, okay, a comative, one part water, one part white Jesus, a half to one powdered sedative. It never failed. A bowl or two of that, they lapped it up, and they'd be goo-gooing like sucklings, all pooped out, all the mad air slaked, the feral statics, the heat waves abated. I would sit and nod and nanny these lumping fadgers of incumbent dung. There were no in-between moods, no slippers brought to the bedside, no hobble around the block. Either those brutes were in a state of high coma or they were coming at your face. But that's the way it had to be. That's the way I wanted it. It's the way God had it organized. That pack of riggish bitches and low bloods, oh, they will get their chance to make good, like me. They will have their moment of glory too, and very soon, I think, and very soon. Let the sleeping dogs lie, but don't believe a word they say. I am the truth, I am the light, every dog has its day. I am having mine now. My time is nigh. You're too late, Mr. Hayrake, Mr. Spade. I said, hey, boss, take up that cross and put on your walking shoes. Yes, you lose, Mr. Noose. Today belongs to me, not thee. Me. Me. This day is mine. Into the ranks of the elite I climb, saying, this is the last day. This is the last day. The last day is mine. There are plenty of others, brothers. Take your pick. Take your hoe, take your goddamn gallow. Leave this day alone, sit through all your yesterdays. Don't count on your tomorrows. I can see them coming and it's not a pretty sight. The fear is here, the fright. Here is the night.